to Brews and Boxing. I am Raider Live. Thank you for joining us another week of insightful boxing news. With me is our panel of experts, as always. First one is Filthy Rich. Filthy Rich, how you doing tonight?
I'm good, man. LeBron James has been named the captain of the Western Conference All-Star team. And big news in the world of the entire universe. Perseverance has landed on Mars. And with Perseverance, guess who's with them? Guess who's with them, boys?
I don't know.
Somebody did try that in pre-show.
That's all I got.
doesn't know what a green screen is.
I tried, man. Yeah. Trying to switch it up a bit.
On podcast, you saw an epic fail of a background on Zoom that did not work. I think it probably worked for the judge up there since he's got the white background. But
that's what it's Mars.
Mickey's mantle definitely got in the way of that one. But moving on, our other expert is the one, the only Judge Jimmy James. Judge, how you doing?
I'm pretty good.
Are you in on Earth or are you in space?
Zoom no, space? Well, I'm on Earth, but I don't know exactly how I feel about this because it looks like Carson Wentz was just traded to the Indianapolis Colts. So Wentz got his wish. The Colts got their replacement for old trusty Rivers. So we'll see what 2021 brings for the Colts. And
sounds like a bad Saturday morning cartoon. Wentz's wish.
Yeah.
He got his wish to go to the Colts.
Yeah.
You know, who's upset about that is Pat McAfee, if you guys have watched that, the fellow podcaster. He is very upset by that. But anyway, we're not talking football here. We're talking boxing. We got a lot of brews and news to get to today. We also have a brews and reviews for some fights this last week and a brews and previews for a fight coming up. So you guys ready?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, ring that bell.
I'll ring the bell. All right, first thing we do in Brews and News, of course, since the name of the show is Brews and News, is we pop a brew. So, gentlemen, I already had one open, so I'm going to open a new one here just so I can double fist it, I guess. So, cheers.
Oh, cheers.
And for our loyal listeners, too, if you didn't know, if you don't drink beer, first off, shame on you, but for if you don't drink beer and you want to be bolder like the rest of us, try Ginger Ale Canada Dry Bold. It's from the makers of Tecate.
Hey, I'm drinking Labatt. We got some Canadian connection here.
Ooh, that was actually a question on my trivia show last week. Is what team did Labatt Blue own up until the late 2000s? You guys know
the Maple Leafs.
Baseball.
The Blue Jays.
The Blue Jays is correct. Everybody said Brewers, and I'm like, no, Labatt is Canadian. It actually looks like, if you see it too, it actually has the logo on it.
Anyway, I thought.
Little fun little trivia. All right, first bit of news we're going to get into is our friend Adrian Broner is back in the news. And after this week, he'll be able to supersize that Subway meal because he'll have more than $13. He returns to the ring this Saturday with the quote, "I'm going to be world champion again and again and again and again." That many agains, that means he must lose a lot of fights, losing the title several times and getting it back. But we'll start with you, Filthy Rich, about what do you think about AB returning to the ring, making that money?
Well, anyone who loses that many times, I mean, even Ric Flair lost that many times, so maybe he's trying to be, like, go down as the greatest, but that's a different story for another time. It's not like this is going to be some exciting fight. And to be honest, I'm more excited about the undercard with heavyweights Otto Wallin and the Colorado quarterback, the guy Wilder knocked out. I'm more excited for – who am I thinking of, man? What's the guy's name?
I don't know.
Brazil. Dominic Brazil and Otto Wallin. I think both of those two – what's that?
He was a quarterback?
He played quarterback at Colorado. Yeah, 6'7" dude, didn't cut in the NFL, and I don't know where he didn't cut it, but boxing was an outlet, and that's where he went. But this Broner fight, this should be an easy fight for him. I don't know what's going on with this weight. He was supposed to, I believe he was supposed to fight at 140, and now they've moved it to 147. So yeah, there are a lot of Subway supersize, whatever it's called, in his future. If he's not going to make weight and just fight at 147, this should be an easy fight for him. I got nothing much to add outside of that.
Well, Judge, what do you got to add? Because I know you have a lot to say about Adrian Broner, AB, your guy. I mean, you bought his rap, his albums and everything, right?
Oh, yeah, when he had his little rap career stint for about 6 months. That was great. I don't even remember his rap name. It was terrible. Twin. I'm sure it was. Oh, Twin. There you go.
he's gonna be on the shelf with Roy Jones pretty soon.
Oh, God. Yeah, I mean, this is...
The mantle is where we keep famous sports heroes and terrible music, apparently.
I'm done with you.
Yeah, I don't have too much to add. This is interesting. I mean, this guy is a nobody. He is straight up Puerto Rican, so maybe he'll harness his Miguel Cotto and see if he can do something against Broner. But I mean, Broner's been out of the game for 2 years. This is just a tune up. If Broner still has anything, I mean, I wouldn't count this guy out. I mean, he doesn't have anybody on his record, but like I said, he's a different style of fight. See if Broner's
not a world champion that he's going to beat again.
No, this is not a world champion at all. However, Broner did say that he doesn't know how this guy feels, but he is willing to die. And I don't know what that means. So, if anything, this should just be entertaining for commentary afterwards, regardless if he wins or loses. I'm going to be looking forward to that, to whoever interviews AB for sure.
I wish it was you. That'd be awesome.
I want to quickly add here to, the guy has losses to like Porter and Kell Brook and Manny Pacquiao. If this really is just a tune-up fight, I'm prepared to look towards the future for him. And a couple names come to mind. Someone like Keith Thurman. I mean, the two of them were just jawing back and forth a few months ago, where he said the kid slaps him, the kid slaps him back, something like that. Errol Spence could potentially beat up Broner. That'd be a fun fight. Errol hasn't fought in a while. Jamal James needs to be tested. Ugas should be tested. I think Mikey Garcia makes sense for someone like Broner, who, if he could make 140, even Mikey Garcia.
He lost to Garcia already.
Did Mikey Garcia beat?
Yeah.
What you got, Raider? I got a couple more.
My question is, you said these guys, the guys you all listed, need to be tested. So why do you want to put them against Adrian Broner? It's not much of a test.
Well, if Broner, you know, if he's willing to die out there, then one of these guys can hopefully kill him. I don't
know
kill.
Where the test part comes in. Where's the
well,
test?
Like,
whether they show up, whether he can pass the drug test or what?
Look, Broner's no easy out. He is like a gatekeeper at this division. If you want to make a name for yourself, you still got to get past Broner. Broner is still a good fighter. Now, is he over the hill at this point? Is missing weight and stuff like that? Maybe. Maybe we shock the world. I don't mean we, but his opponent may shock the world here. But outside of like Lipinets and Hooker as opponents, Raider, you're like this guy. Gerard Ennis could fight him. That would be a passing of the torch. And and regardless of what you think about Broner, he still draws in big dollars. And you know who always takes a big dollar fight? You guessed it. Say it.
Oh no, you tell me.
Amir Khan. Move with me, James. Move with me.
Dance to this.
Amir Khan versus Adrian Broner.
Why not? I think it would draw big money.
What weight would you fight that one at?
Wherever they can meet. Yeah. 140. I think Amir Khan can make 140. I think he can make 140. I think his last fight was at 147. But Khan and Broner, I think would make for a good fight. Loser retires. How about that?
I'll drink to that.
Yeah. Copyright Filthy Rick.
I think there's a better chance of Adrian Broner's creditors getting paid than there is of that fighter. Or Adrian Broner shocking the world. I think whatever.
What you say?
You said you want to watch the interview after that fight, James. It has to be Larry Merchant. So Larry Merchant could tell him he was 100 years younger now, he'd beat the hell out of him.
Yeah, maybe. Why not, right? Yeah. He'll probably just hit him. He won't even ask the question anymore. He's old enough now where he'll just hit people.
He ain't feeling nothing below the neck anyway. Happy birthday, Larry Merchant. I know we told you last week, but still. I like he's still kicking around. And he could. Hey, there's the fight. Larry Merchant versus Adrian Broner. I'll pay to see that.
Sign me up.
All right, moving on to the next bit of question. If you joined us because you saw our Andre Ward Canelo question on Max Kellerman, we've been posting that little clip all around, and a lot of people have seen it. We've actually been posting on some websites, and this whole thing started with a judge to the max question from Filthy Rich to Max Kellerman from Brews and Boxing. And this has blown up. I wish we'd get more cred for it, but it has blown up, and it originated right here. Right here, I'm telling you. Now I see a lot of the things that people are talking about is not only will Andre Ward fight Canelo, but will he come out of retirement, period? Filthy Rich, I want to start with you. Do you think Andre Ward will come out of a retirement? If he does, do you think the steam that we created is going to face or force a Canelo fight?
So there's a couple things to touch on there. For one, I guess congratulations to Brews and Boxing. I think we are the only show to have our logo pop up there 2 weeks in a row. That was pretty cool. Andre Ward. Now, Andre Ward coming out of retirement, one of the first things he said when he went into retirement was the hardest part of retiring was staying retired. On the other hand, money talks. So if the dollars are there, I believe he comes out of retirement. But here's the plot twist. I don't think he takes a Canelo fight. He prefers to fight someone like Anthony Joshua. I think if the money is there, he will come out of retirement. If the money is there, the money's probably not going to be there. My money would be on no, he doesn't come out of retirement. But if he does, I don't think he takes a Canelo fight. I think he moves straight to Anthony Joshua. But even a tune-up fight someone like Usyk, somebody more your size. I don't know. He's not really a tune-up fight, but Andre Ward's been out of the game for a long time. If he comes out of retirement, there won't be a Canelo fight.
Would it be in a heavyweight fight, or would it be in that new heavyweight division, that lower heavyweight division?
That Bridgerweight. No, it sounds like he wants to move straight to heavyweight. I don't think anyone's really recognizing this Bridgerweight division. I don't think the Bridgerweight division will be there a few years from now.
That's a large jump to go from Canelo to Anthony Joshua.
That's what I said. I don't know what he's thinking, but, you know, according to him, if he were to come out, he would prefer to fight Joshua over Canelo. So go ahead and do it. If I'm in his corner or on his management team, which was Rock Nation at one time, I would tell him to fight Canelo. There's probably more money in a Canelo fight. It's probably an easier win. And we've talked about risk reward. I think it's a too high risk to fight Anthony Joshua. And I think Andre Ward, like Max said, if he's at 100%, can beat Canelo.
I got a fight for you for Andre Ward. He's going to come out of retirement and wants the money. Oscar De La Hoya. Oscar De La Hoya says he can beat up anybody still. Andre Ward's been retired, says prove it, and comes back, beats the crap out of Oscar De La Hoya, and becomes a hero of the nation. Judge, you're shaking your head. What do you think?
Oh, just becomes a hero of a nation. That's what I'm laughing at. But
telling me that wouldn't be a big money fight? I guarantee that'd be a big money fight.
I mean, well, to have De La Hoya get his teeth knocked out, yeah, why not? I'd like to see that. Who wouldn't like to see that? But
De La Hoya?
Well, that's fair. I mean, he's got enough money, he can just get fake teeth. You know, but yeah, man, I mean, this is interesting. I didn't really see the Joshua thing. I think that's a little 6'7", You're 6 feet tall there, Ward. That's a lot.
Rocky versus Drago there. That's
yeah.
Is.
I mean, if you're trying to recreate Nintendo's Mike Tyson's punch out, you're trying to be Little Mac, then I guess. But I don't know. I mean, this would be crazy if he came out of retirement. I'm pretty surprised that it still has this much draw. So, you know, 2 weeks later, but yeah, that just proves it's a real good question. Got a lot of people going back and forth about this, but yeah, I mean, it'd be tough to see him come out of retirement, but yeah, I mean, he's definitely been an announcer at enough Canelo fights that he probably knows how to beat him. So why not? And he's rested 4 years rested.
And he's not that old. Was he 34?
36.
Yeah. That old. Canelo's what? He's in his 30s, isn't he?
I think he's 31 now, which seems still super young for him, but something like that.
Well, I say do it, Ward. Come out, and then we're going to take credit for that, too. Maybe we can be on ESPN before that happens. You know? And if you found us because of this, thank you. Please tell your friends and spread the news. We are on podcasts and on YouTube at www.youtube.com/RaiderLive, RaiterLive. You get to see Filthy Rich's terrible Zoom background.
Oh, man. And, I'm done with you again.
All right, final bit of news got to get into here. Wouldn't be a show with the judge if we didn't talk a little Terrence Crawford. Terrence Crawford taking his ball and going home, says he'll never ask for a Spence fight again after, you know, seeing Spence train and see that you know, the fear in Terrence Crawford's eyes when he said this quote, I'll never ask for a Spence fight again. James, you probably looked at that a little differently, so I'll let you go ahead.
Well, differently, I guess. I mean, it's been back and forth, man, like over and over and over that we're trying to get this, and they're going back on the A side, 50-50 ain't good enough, 60-40 ain't good enough. Like, this stuff is just ridiculous as it's going back and forth, man. So I still think that this is a fight that still needs to happen. The longer this goes, the longer this is probably never going to happen, especially if he doesn't care about it anymore. I don't know. I believe that this is a Bob Arum issue. I think Arum is the problem in this whole equation, or at least maybe not Arum, but the promotions, like the promoters, not just the split here. As far as I'm concerned, if you have a fight like this and you got two guys that are literally, you know, swanging each other, why don't you just sit there and go, look, you each are going to get 40%. Whoever wins the fight gets the extra 20. You fight for your money. There you go. Then you actually have a fight and you have something to fight for. If you guys just don't care about back and forth, you want to be the A side, prove you're the A side. Don't get knocked out, knock the other one out, or win that fight, get that money. Then there you go. No more issues, no more problems. If you win, you get that cash. Let's do it.
Well, they'll probably all say that, oh, well, the judging was fixed. I say, well, if it goes to the cards, then it's a 50-50 split. There you go. Knock them out, you get 60. If it goes to the cards, you get 55. If you win on the cards, you get 55. If it's a split decision, it's 50. There you go. Hire me. Bob Arum. Call. We've already been in touch with ESPN. Call me. Yeah, we got this all settled right now. Perfect.
Yeah.
Filthy Rich, what do you think?
Yeah, I think both of you guys nailed it. I don't know what I'm doing here tonight. If there was something I will add to this is the whole Bob Arum thing. Let's not forget just a few months ago, Bob Arum's talking about, I could have bought a house with the money I lost. So what is Crawford still doing with Bob Arum? He should have split with him by now. I still think a split could be coming, but if Bob Arum's still a part of this equation, the fight's not going to happen. I don't think it happens anytime soon. And I don't know if I necessarily care to see this fight. I think the fight could be made at 154 a couple years from now. But according to the source, the article, the part of the reason why he doesn't, you know, quote unquote, doesn't care for this fight is because a couple new opponents have been lined up for him. Someone like Pacquiao and someone like Sean Porter have been lined up. Now, the problem with both of these is Pacquiao is demanding a $40 million payday plus a 75-25 split. All that can be negotiated because it sounds like Terrence Crawford's asking for $10 million, and that would be a pay raise for Crawford. This is what happened with Wilder and Anthony Joshua. Wilder was offered, you know, three times the amount of his last fight and turned it down because he wanted a 50-50 split. That just wasn't going to happen. But if Arum or Al Haymon, whoever, can to get Terrence Crawford that $10 million, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. On top of that, negotiating down from 75-25 to maybe 60-40, I could see Terrence Crawford taking that, saying, I got a bunch of money for this fight. All I got to do is beat this guy, and if I get a rematch clause in this, I'll get 60-40. That's how Roy Jones used to do it. It was 80-20, and if you can beat him, then you get to call the shots. You can get 80-20, but Roy put butts in seats. Pacquiao puts butts in seats. Pacquiao sells pay-per-views across the world. And going back to what Bob Arum said about promoting with Terrence Crawford, he could have bought a house with the money he's lost. This might help Crawford in the promotion game. As far as Porter goes, Porter's being offered $2 million, which isn't an increase from his last fight. So to make a Porter fight happen, you're going to have to offer him more money. Out of the two opponents there, I think everyone wants to put Pacquiao on the resume. I think that's the more enticing offer. If I'm Terrence Crawford, Errol Spence will be there a few years from now. Take the Pacquiao fight.
I may be wrong here, but I think Porter is a more dangerous fight for Crawford than Pacquiao is at this point.
No, you're absolutely right. I'll drink to that.
I think Porter has a better chance of beating Crawford than Pacquiao does. I just don't see Pacquiao at this stage putting up the kind of fight that Crawford can. And Porter's just so tough. He's like a piece of iron. You can't hurt him. You can't knock him back. I don't know. I think he's dangerous. I don't think I'd want to fight Porter for the less money. Take that $10 million and fight Pacquiao and get that legendary win. That's the way I look at it. Jim, you want to say something? Sorry.
I don't know what Crawford's being offered for the Porter fight. I know he's getting offered $10 million for Pacquiao, but he may not be offered $10 million to fight Porter. So
I doubt he's getting $10 million to fight Porter.
That's still my guess, too.
But that would still be a more dangerous fight, in my opinion. And you'd have a lot more to lose if you lost to Porter. That's absolutely. James, what do you think? You're up there looking like you're
just a bit. I just don't agree. I don't think Porter is not anyone to look over by any means, but as far as the dangerous fight, Pacquiao seems to transcend time. So and he is just sneaky. So I don't know if I agree with that statement, but that's
here's the thing. He's sneaky, but I think all three of us would agree that Pacquiao doesn't have the power to knock out Crawford. Yes, no.
I don't know if it boils down to power. You can knock somebody out if you hit somebody enough times in the same spot.
Like, yeah, you're and sometimes about you get technical. Hit in the testicles, but that's not the point. I'm saying, does he have the power to? He doesn't have the power of a Porter, and Porter's got a stronger chin than Pacquiao does. You know, he's going to keep coming at you. He's going to beat you up more. I think Crawford would take more damage in a Porter fight than he would take in a Pacquiao.
I think I would disagree with that.
I'm going with Raider on this one, man. Yeah, I can't face. Remember the. I mean, I can't remember the last time Pacquiao knocked someone out at 147. Now I can say the same thing about Porter, but I think Porter's the more dangerous fight. Going back to the risk reward, I think Porter's a riskier fighter with a smaller reward. Why not go after an old guy? At some point, Father Time's going to catch up to Pacquiao, and Crawford could be the guy that beats him, puts him into retirement, and. Who even gets to fight Pacquiao anymore? Everyone wants Pacquiao before he's done.
Yeah, I mean, you remember the Spence Porter fight? Porter's a tough guy. You know, that was a very, very scary fight for Spence too. I don't think Spence wants to jump back in the ring with Porter anytime soon. You know, it's like He just keeps coming at you. He's all wrong for you, baby. All wrong for you. You guys got that reference? No?
No.
Oh, Rocky 2. Why don't you want to fight Rocky? Or why don't you want me to fight him? He's all wrong for us, baby. I saw you beat that man, and he just kept coming after you. We don't need that kind of man in our life. And that's Porter. That's the way I look at it. So, and that's my final little dig at the judge for my Terrence Crawford dig of the day. But I think Terrence Crawford wins both fights. I just think Porter's the more dangerous fighter of the two. That's his fight. And I think Filthy Rich thinks I'm right. All right. You guys ready to move on to Brews and Reviews?
Yes. I'll drink please. To that. Yeah, I'll drink to you, Raider Live. I'll drink on to the next segment.
Brews and Reviews is where we talk about a fight that happened the past weekend or past week sometimes, if it's a not a big deal fight, or if it's in London and it's 5 a.m. or whatever it is. But the first one, it was a big upset. I hope you had these tickets cashed in Vegas. Warrington versus Lara. James, you watched it and sent it to us right away. I'll let you recap it. I mean, I watched it too, but I'm going to let you recap it here. And then, Rich, I'm going to move on to you about what happens next from there. But we're going to start with the judge here about recapping this amazing upset.
Well, I mean, it's, I don't know. It's, I don't know. Let's, okay, let's just start at the beginning. There's been a layoff, right? Warrington hasn't fought in almost a year and a half. Mauricio Lara, I don't really know much about him. I looked, obviously a Mexican style fighter, didn't really have anybody on his resume as far as that goes. But I mean, this should have been a walk in the park. Warrington literally, which I'm going to give credit to Rich, because I didn't even realize this because I completely forgot about it earlier in the show, that he vacated his belt when he was supposed to rematch Kid Galahad. Mm-hmm. So this wasn't even for a belt. So this Lara dude was just going in for just a straight beatdown. Now, I thought that this would be easy. Warrington's in the UK. It's hometown. You know, he's the Leeds Warrior. Would have came in, and man, he didn't look right. So he came out
sick.
So he came out firing. It looked like, I think he thought that he was just going to knock this dude out like that. Like it was going to be, I'm going to 1-2 rounds. This guy's going to be done. I'm going to go get my payday and I'm going to move on. And that's just not what happened at all. I actually don't know in retrospect if he's actually fought someone with the same style, with a Mexican style that moves forward like Lara. Because it's like he couldn't. So it was super weird. So Warrington looked like he was doing all right and looked like everything was happening, no problem, until like the fourth round, when all of a sudden he got hit like 4 or 5 times with just some hook shots to his face. And he wasn't right. Like he was a stanky leg and wandering around. And I thought the ref was going to call it then. Cause it was, that close, man. If there would have been like 10 more seconds in that round, I think it would have just called it then, but didn't call it, kept going. Lara picked up a little bit here and there, Warrington picked up a little bit here and there. And then, I don't know, man, that ninth round comes around and I don't know if he was tired or he started getting overzealous, but he left himself open to some brutal shots to the face that just, it was boom, boom. And then Lara had like 3 shots, like right in a row, just like left hooks, just pat, 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 pat. And Warrington just was done. Like he just dropped, didn't get up. Barely got up. And then the ref called it. It was so uncharacteristic. I don't know if it was just because of the layoff or if it was a mismatch in styles, but that was crazy to see. It was super disappointing because I thought Warrington had, you know, he was good at the featherweight division, but this really knocks him down big. He's not a one for power, but he definitely ain't one to just get rocked like that. Even after Lara knocked him out, he literally pointed at the doctors to come and you got to help this man, which was kind of crazy to see. I thought he was trying to give him a fist bump, and it was, no, that's not the same thing. It was like, come over here and check him out. So, yeah, I mean, this was uncharacteristic for Warrington. Maybe this is just a byproduct of COVID. Having too much time off shows how important it is to keep active. But man, that was unfortunate to see, but congratulations, Laura. you'll at least get one more big fight off of this.
Yeah. Well, we're going to go to Filthy Rich here in one quick second about the future of what this, what next for both, but a real kind of loser in this too is Zhu Khan, because, you know, he had a fight lined up with Warrington, I think, after this, and that was probably going to be the biggest money fight he was going to have. That fight's got to be off now, I'd imagine. You know, we're going to have a rematch with Lara. So that kind of sucks for Zhu Khan. You know, he's probably watching going, that's terrible. I just lost a lot of money there.
Ah, there's plenty to go around at the 130. So, or, I mean, not 130, 126. So I don't think he's not losing that much, but yeah, that was
the big money fight.
That's a big money fight. Fastest hands in the West.
That was
he's sitting out there.
It's not like a Kid Galahad fight. I mean, Filthy Rich, what's next for Warrington, Lara, and I'll even throw in Zhu Khan there. What's next for the three guys?
Yeah, so like even with Lara, if I'm on his side, I say something like take a tune-up fight. Take a no-name up-and-comer guy that you should be able to beat, sit on that belt, get some recognition. Now you got a target on your back.
Wait, there is no belt.
There was no belt on the line. That's okay. Yeah. Well, go after a belt then. I don't know who has a belt, but now's the time to make a name for yourself. Don't give Warrington a rematch. I don't know if there was a rematch clause. Usually the A-side or the headliner is not the one to throw in a rematch clause, because if they win, they can just move on and they probably won't lose. So if I'm Lara, I go after either a no-name dude to build some more recognition, and then maybe go after one of the alphabet titles. I don't know where the titles are spread out at this point, but sit on this victory for a little bit. Enjoy your time. Don't take a Warrington rematch. Let Warrington go out there and build himself up. And now how does Warrington do that? I mean, there are a lot of outlets he can take. Someone like Isaac Dogbe comes to mind, someone who's trying to build his name back up. Santa Cruz took a big loss the last time we saw him. If Santa Cruz wants to stay at 126, a Warrington fight could be a big money fight. Ray Vargas has been ranked pretty high, according to Ring Magazine. I think Warrington was number one. This has got to drop him and put Santa Cruz right there at the top, along with like someone like Gary Russell. If Gary Russell's still at 126, that makes a lot of sense. Nyan Bayar is always going to be out there. I don't know how much of a career he has left, but my dark horse in all of this, we talked about this when we first started doing rankings almost a year ago. I see a smile on James's face. I'm not going to ask him who he's thinking, but Mikey Conlan, this is a time for him to shine. So if I'm Lara, I stay away from Conlan. But if I'm Conlan, I go after any of the names I mentioned, because that dude is going to be the future, at least of this division, some point very soon.
I gotta hit this breaking news button. We do have breaking news when it comes to this. Warrington has taken the rematch clause and will fight Lara this summer in a rematch. And Eddie Hearn has also signed Lara to a two-fight deal, saying that he may be the next big star overnight. So Warrington suffered a concussion in the fight. He said he's not doing well, but this is BoxingNews24.com is stating that the rematch will be this summer. And so we got that. And Lara was quickly signed. He's only 22 years old, so which is weird. 22 years old, and he's 22-2 with 15 knockouts.
I think it was reported. I saw James point to the jawline there that Warrington may have had a broken jaw, but reports or X-rays.
Doesn't say anything about a broken jaw. It says he had a concussion. He was for sure
Right, but like it was stated that he may have had a broken jaw, but those, I mean, the reports a day ago said right. that his jaw is not broken. Right. So I guess there was a rematch clause. I don't know.
Yep. So I guess that's what's going to happen. It's going to happen this summer. If Warrington loses that one, it could be it for Warrington for a while. That's a big. Well, that's what they're saying on the comments on.
Ooh, that Conlon versus Warrington. That's Ireland versus the UK. That would have been sweet. Oh, man, that would have filled up Wembley Stadium in a heartbeat.
All right. Definitely. We got that. We got one more review that we have to touch on here. James, you want to rematch the Teixeira versus Costano?
Yeah, if you didn't see this is the undercard for the Jojo Diaz Rakhmatov. I don't even remember the Russian dude. This
would it be Serbia or any of those because they're all the same, right?
No, it was, I don't know. I don't know. I got, that's poor reporting on my part. Patrick Teixeira against Brian Costano. Man, that was a good fight. I remember watching these guys. I think it was when we had our first ever like live. These guys were on the undercard of the Charlo stuff. But they were both fighting for something. And I think Teixeira, because he's only been, he had a belt. I can't remember who he beat. But he only lost to Curtis Stevens, right? He's the only person that's ever knocked him out. And Teixeira is like a taller dude for his division, almost 6 feet tall. For the 154 and a really long reach. So he's got some size, and Costano's just a shorter dude. But man, if you want to talk about coming to play, Costano came to play. He was nonstop pressure cutting off the ring. It didn't look like he was the challenger. It looked like he was the man holding the belt in that fight. It was crazy. It was such a good fight. These guys were going back and forth, but Teixeira just did not have an answer for Costano, and he was hitting him with some ridiculously good shots, man. Especially even with the height difference and everything. This was definitely the best fight of the night, in my opinion. And Costano has only had one blemish, pretty much, which was a draw against Landy Lara. That's obviously Lara's end of his career, but whatever. It's still a big thing. So I think Costano is some real deal to watch out for. He is 31, so he's not a spring chicken by any means.
I resent that remark since I'm turning 40.
Well, you're not fighting at the height of your thing here for the WBO.
I'm fighting you guys every week at the height of my career. What do you guys talk?
Yeah, fair enough. But yeah, this is that was definitely the fight of the show. I did not think it was going to happen like that by any means. But man, watch out for this guy. he's going to be coming up real quick.
Wait a minute, you're telling me it stole the spotlight from a Jojo Diaz fight?
Yes, yes, it did.
Filthy Rich, how's this shape up the 154?
Well, first, we're going to quickly just gloss over Jojo Diaz missing weight by over 3 pounds. I don't even think he deserves to be talked about.
He needs Chipotle some, the day before weigh-in.
He need, you know, and he can point all the fingers he wants. Everyone has to make weight, whether it's COVID or not. It's disrespectful to miss weight. And apparently when you're over by 3 pounds, they don't give you a second chance. If you're over by, I think it's the limit is 2, you get like 1 hour to try to make that weight back. Because he hit 3.6 or something, he got no second chance. So, talk about Jojo Diaz. Yeah, he's off to the side. He needs to move up in weight or we can't talk about him here anymore. As far as like this Costano fight goes, I'm reading somewhere here that he is actually with the PBC. So this PBC DAZN fight was able to be made. So Costano, I think he goes back to Fox and he goes back to Showtime, and he has a stable full of guys as opponents, potential opponents. And obviously the first name that comes to mind is someone like Jermell Charlo. This, as if Charlo hasn't already stamped his name on this division, this is one more name to add to his list. Erickson Lubin hasn't fought in a while. That'd be a good fight. Irislandi Lara is probably looking for an opponent. He doesn't have a fan-friendly style, but it is what it is. Someone like Liam Smith should be an easy fight for Costano if he just wants to. He's a DAZN fighter, like last I checked. So if he stays with DAZN for a little bit, that's a fight that can be made. That's a fight that he can win, even if Teixeira wants to go that route. Sebastian Fondora is looking for a big fight after whatever win he had just recently. I think that was on the Charlo pay-per-view. Swift Hurd, probably looking for an opponent. I know he's been jawing back and forth with one of the Charlos. That fight's probably going to take some time to build up, but I had a dark horse last time for Raider. This is a dark horse for Jimmy James. Israel Madrimov at 154. Ooh. I think the dream, the little G, I think he's the one we can see him. We can see both fighters being tested. So Costano Madrimov would be something I'd like to see set up in the near future.
Ooh, I like it.
Would you like that fight like even it. More than a fight against Amir Khan?
I'll drink to that.
Watch that. Amir Khan. All right.
Two times.
Oh. Yeah, apparently James doesn't want to watch an Amir Khan fight. I do.
No. Don't.
We're watching it on your garage. It's going to happen.
Ugh.
All right, let's move on to Brews and Previews here. Brews and Previews, where we preview an upcoming fight. This fight that we're talking about this week is Berchalt versus Valdez. I started with James a lot here, so I'm going to start with Filthy Rich. What should we look for in Berchalt versus Valdez?
I hate to steal all of James's thunder here, but like...
He's got no thunder left.
It's okay. Okay, good. I'll take his lightning while I'm at it too then. Berchalt has come forward fast, no defense, throw punches, everything, the whole works.
Early.
Yes. Look for, probably 100 punches thrown per round, maybe even by each fighter. I don't know how Oscar Valdez wins this fight. I haven't been impressed by his last few fights. He pulls off victories against lesser opponents, but Berchalt has made his name beating up the toughest guys in his division. So the only way, Oscar Valdez beats Miguel Berchalt is trying to beat Berchalt at his own game, and that's going to be throwing 100 punches per round. The numbers on this fight, the ratings should be high. This is the fight you want to see. I don't think they're going to be as high. They're competing with Adrian Broner, so I can see the audience going to that channel. But this is the fight I will be watching and what to look out for. Bunch of punches, nonstop offense. This is going to be fireworks, folks.
You got anything to add to that, Jane?
Yeah, I can add some stuff for sure, man.
Yeah, I want to take your
time. We're out of time. Okay.
No, come on.
I'm just kidding.
No, I mean, this is Berchalt's seventh title defense, so there's a reason why his warrior-like style definitely proves to be a winning combination. But I got to agree with what Rich is saying. It's going to be difficult. I don't know if Valdez is going to have to. He's probably going to have to be more technical. He's going to have to choose his punches wisely and do some counter punching to actually wear him down somehow. And I don't know if that's going to happen because you got two Mexican style fighters and I don't know. I don't know if you can wear Berchalt down. He's just a naturally bigger dude. So even though they're the exact same height, but he's just built. So I agree with Rich. You're going to want to watch this. This is going to be fireworks. Billy Blanks, Tybo.
This is a top-ranked fight, right? It's on ESPN. Berchalt
is top-ranked, right? Free ESPN. Yep.
Berchalt is top-ranked, I thought, right?
Both of them.
Just peek at the odds here real fast here. Valdez is undefeated, but he's coming in at a 3-1 underdog. $435 bet on Berchalt wins you 100. So Filthy Rich is saying put your mortgage on Berchalt and do it early. and yeah,
again, like,
is that a nod? Yes, holy cow, you're talking about gambling.
No, I just mean, like, I agree with something. I mean, what the money you win, donate it to your favorite shelter. There's or shelter or charity, whatever you got to do. But Berchalt has fought the tougher opponents. I think he's what, like 37-1 with like over 30 knockouts, where Valdez more like 26-28-0. But has taken on lesser opponents. And even with those lesser opponents, there were some close fights in there that he pulled off.
He's got big.
He was our guy back in the day.
I know.
He?
That's why I was freaking
out. Go check out what episode 16 or that's something. That's why I brought go it look up. Just last season. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That week.
Valdez is a good fighter. I think this is too much for him. Berchalt is just unstoppable. There's got to come a point where I don't know if he has to move up, maybe a fight with Jojo Diaz, beat him back into fighting weight. I don't know, but if we're going to do predictions, I'm taking Berchalt.
That was going to be my next question, was predictions.
Valdez coming to with it. I'll drink to that.
6-inch reach disadvantage. You're saying Berchalt, but you have to predict what it is too. Is it a decision, knockout? And if it's a knockout, what round?
Probably go to decision. I'm thinking it's going to be a unanimous decision. I'm looking something like 8-4, something like that.
Judge?
Man, that's going to be tough, but I got to go with Berchalt as well. I think his style, his expertise is going to be a little too much for this guy. I honestly think that it's probably going to go to a TKO in like the 11th.
I will go straight up knockout by Berchalt in the 10th. So all three of us are in agreement. Berchalt, we all say it's going to go at least 10 rounds, and we'll go from there. So hopefully we're not wrong, but we rarely are. So put your money on it. All right, Filthy Rich, why don't you bring us home?
Just want to say, you know, give a big shout out and love to my family out in Houston going through all this whole thing, the whole Dirty South going through all this stuff with those temps, man. Be safe, guys.
Yep, got to learn how we do it here in Minnesota. It's tough without power. I mean, you can't do it without power, but just make the best of it. Like me and the judge do, we just go fishing when it's negative 15. That's what we do. It doesn't feel as cold after that when you're standing outside negative 15 in the wind.
Fair.
Judge, if they're listening to us, where can they watch us? If they're watching us, where can they listen to us?
Well, if you're listening to us, you can watch us on YouTube/RaiderLive. If you're listening or if you're watching us, man, messed it up. That's all right.
Blew it.
If you're watching us and you want to listen to us, you can get us on all the major podcast sites, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Google, the whole nine yards. Just talk to your smart speaker, tell them to play Brews and Boxing, and then you'll hear our beautiful voices whenever you do it.
They are sexy voices. All right. Well, I'd like to give a big thank you to everybody out there that's found us over this last 2 weeks that we've gotten our little publicity run here. I really appreciate that. I hope you enjoy the show. I hope you share it with your friends. I'd also like to thank Max Kellerman for putting us on the show there. That was great as well. And I'd like to thank Amir Khan for just being you. For Judge Jimmy James and Filthy Rich, I am Raider Live. Thank you guys for joining us, and we will see you guys next week.